I think in some ways I looked at music as something, a great lifestyle, an enjoyable lifestyle, until I got a real job, to be honest. I didn't really, you know, I didn't think that much of, I didn't think I was talented enough or anything to really even make $1 out of it to live, to eat. We were trying to, you know, go into pubs and do something that nobody had really ever seen before, which was kind of make people dance, not just go like this and throw beer cans at you and stuff, and pick fights, you know. Not everywhere, but a lot of places were like that. And so I think Tim had a pair of congas, yeah, and he was playing those as well. And we were just, you know, just experimenting and trying funk and all kinds of stuff. And a lot of it was really dismal and, you know, and horrible. We couldn't find a style. It just couldn't. It was like fusion almost, which I can't stand, you know. And so I was nearly out of there for sure. I was like, I can't handle all this. I'm going to go home and start a punk band or something, or a disco band, anything. And I think we're all getting like that. And then we started to get a semblance of a style and started figuring out, and that's where the R&B comes in, where it was the best of both worlds, where we could have big Marshall stacks, but the guys were playing funky rhythm section. 12-hour drive, that is. And then back again, and so, you know, you start to get a name and the record companies come to you, which is the great independence of the Australian music scene. Is, they have to sign you. They're stupid if they don't.
You've had a long-term relationship with Chris Thomas, the producer who first worked with you on the Listen Like Thieves album. How did it begin?
He sort of started stalking us, and he kept on popping up at these shows all around the world because he saw us somewhere, I think in Japan. I think he was living in Japan at the stage. And he kept on turning up, and we got to know him. We became a friend. And he kept on scratching his head saying, how come you don't sound anything like you do on record that you do live?
What You Need was your first US Top 20 success. Did you feel it with your hit when you wrote it?
In fact, it wasn't even recorded. It was just sitting around, and he kept on saying, we need one more song, we need one more song that really defines this album, or where you're going. And we kept on listening, and we listened to it again, and thought, okay, let's start working on this. Yeah. It was the last song we recorded, with like hours to spare.
By now, I mean, if Chris Thomas managed to calm you down, Listen Like Thieves, and take those stars out of your eyes, it must have been a bit harder by the time you come back to do Kick.
I think we were like kids, really, just bubbling over, you know, just very excited that and unbelieving in some ways. We're still a pretty cynical bunch, you know, being Australian, we're a bit, you know, don't trust them. And so we just tried to keep our heads together, and went back in the studio, and Kick started really turning out very well. And I remember Needed Tonight, which ended up doing quite well, and it was this song that it was a throwaway song, actually. Andrew and I wrote it in 5 minutes, literally. It's exactly the way we wrote it, is exactly the way it came out as I read the lyrics on top of the piece of music. And that was it. I remember it was just another video, really. Working with Richard Lowenstein and his crew, Lynn Marie Milburn and Troy Davies, is kind of like a family thing. And it's pretty eccentric, the three of them together. So it was just another day making a video in some ways. I remember my brother came around, Rhett, with his rat, Plague. And I said, let's get Plague in the video. And he came running up here. That's what I remember. I had to come out of the fantasy of the bedroom fantasy of something that you never believed would happen and probably didn't really want to, you know, like anybody has, you know, everybody has this, and because I was, you know, very much just the singer in the band, and no one would think, none of us would thought twice about that, you know. And it's, you know, you got to understand that it's a different scenario, especially being Australian and that kind of thing. It's very egalitarian. And still is, pretty much. So from the fantasy to the reality, that this is actually kind of happening. This is, people keep on, you know, taking bites out of me. The only thing that we could basically rely on is our ability to play live, and we just wanted to bring, you know, I remember we watched AC/DC go around America countless times, and that's really how they broke the States and the rest of the world. And we just thought, we'll apply the same method, you know, simple as that. We weren't really, we didn't want to get too entangled in being video kings or something, even though we loved making videos and stuff, but we didn't want to get, rely on that. We knew that was dangerous.
Mass Q Project, why did you do that?
Why did I do that? I did that as, in some way, in a perverse reaction to what had happened to the band, to be honest, and to me. And I had a hell of a time, I had a great time doing it, except I forgot to tell the band I was going to do it. And I'm going to forget Andrew Corman going, I just saw you on television in your new band. what's it called? Oh, Max Q. Ah, yes. One of my friends, I was having dinner, one of my friends asked me if I'd seen it yet. And so it was really like that. It was just this sort of stream of consciousness that turned into an album, you know. I was just thinking and it happened. But anyway, everybody was happy with it, and yeah, I just should have told them. We had a year off. I mean, no one's in chains here, you know. There was this pressure to, I think because the leaps we'd made in such a short period of time, once we started, got going, you know, from, especially Listen Like Thieves to Kick, were pretty substantial. So we felt like that, I think we really had to make another one. It turned out well. I mean, it turned out well. It turned out a little sounding to me like we were a little reticent, a little nervous sounding, a little conservative for my taste, you know, or quite a lot for my taste, not so much for others. But at least we didn't turn into a blues group all of a sudden or whatever, you know. We try to keep, you know, true, you know. And it did. It was, in fact, now that I listen to it, there's some really good songs in there. When we went in to do Welcome, Andrew and I just went, right, we're gonna put, you know, we're just gonna get everyone out of the way, and you and I are just gonna get back down here, and no one's gonna have anything to say about this for a while, and which is what we did. And in some ways, I think it's our best album. It's a much more subtle album in some ways. It wasn't so sort of pub rocky, you know. It was much more experimental. It was very much a studio album.
60-piece orchestras. And
yeah, you know, one, two, three, go.
You then took the very unusual step. At first, you didn't tour that album.
No.
Know, which is quite unusual for you guys.
Mm.
Why was that?
It just went hand in hand with the album. You know, we just wanted to keep it this little capsule by itself, a studio album.
Right.
And also, we wanted to do more music. After taking that year off, we said we'd never do that again and like that. And it takes too much idle hands, you know, idle minds, and so we went straight back in the studio. So I really wanted to make a much harder record, you know, sort of the opposite to the Welcome thing, much more experimenting in atonals and distortions rather than than what Welcome was like. The older you get and the longer you're in a band, going home becomes a different thing. You know, going home, you come back with stuff that people come back into the studio with stuff I have no comprehension of why they're saying what they're doing and being the way they are, because I don't follow them around into their lives all day long. Whereas years ago, it's much more simple. You're either living together, or when they go home, they're going to sit around the can of baked beans and listen to the bloody tape. We just decided it can be done, you know. We can go from stadiums down to tiny places, and and it keeps that whole pressure off of where do they go, what do they do, and you know, it becomes more of a mystery, and it's, I love it. I love being in, you know, a fairly you know, successful band and playing this to 1,000 people at the Academy in New York, and that's it, you know. And then next, I mean, it took a long time to play all these places in the end. We worked harder than a normal tour, but...
Was it good for you as a band to do, do you think?
Yeah, well, I think it was our make or break tour for ourselves. I mean, we took away all the limos and the giant light shows and blah, blah, you know, and the crap, basically. We just knew that we would either be a band at the end of it, the first show, or the first week, or we wouldn't, you know. Simple as that. And we were, and we really enjoyed it. And actually, we were grinning and just, yeah, this is great. This is the best. This is what we are. I don't need the greatest record in front of me to realize that the band has come to a certain stage in its career. I think for us, it's really good. It actually feels good to have this compendium, you know, this library reference here, there, and when I listen to it, I wonder sometimes what would, you know. It's the only way you can physically turn your life and, you know, into a little history book in some ways, unless we do a book. I was talking to Nick Simmel yesterday about, you know, if you took a Crowded House greatest hits, it would just be these flawless, you know, songs one after another, you know, all this, you know, in a certain field, you know. And with us, it's like, what is that compared to that compared to that? It's quite odd sounding. Andrew says the only thing we've got in common is that we're in INXS, which I think is, in some ways, fairly true. And yeah, because I search for reasons why we still like to get in a room together. Definitely. Because you better have a really good reason after 17 years.
Is it true you sang on Twinkle Twinkle Little Star as a child?
I think it was, thank you for this. It was, it was, yeah, I think it was Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, yeah.
So what was that then? Tell the story for us.
I also do a great rendition of I was a teenage whore. I got a plan to make you a star, make you go rich. I know what happened. I got, you know, dragged into some studio by somebody, and I sang on this little Christmas record. And okay, the full story, me and Prince Charles, it's all out. It was this thing, plastic Santa Claus. Okay, it was red, little beard and all that. And you bought it for kids, and you put this record in. I wish I could find one. Anyone out there got one? Please give it to me. Send it to me. I'll pay good money, good dollar. And you stick this record in, and you get instant, you know, me, singing really badly, Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. I think it was Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star.
It's not in the greatest hits.
It's not in the greatest hits, and I'd push for it, man. VH 1 to 1.